Okay, once we've now saved that spreadsheet, it's time to open up ArcGIS. You can navigate to ArcGIS by using the Start menu and typing in Arc. Once you open it up, it should look something like this, so you probably won't have these maps, which are other things I've been working on. You can just click on the red X button to clear that out of the way. So this is ArcGIS. One of the main things you'll notice is there are kind of several different sections to the screen. The table of contents section looks like this. This is where most of your different layers will be displayed. It might be on the right-hand side. Don't worry about that. This main area in here is the layout view. This is where you're actually going to see the data and see the maps. You might also have the catalog open. I hide mine along here. You may also have the search bar open. Don't worry if you don't have those. We can open them up later if we need to. Now, the first thing we're going to want to do is add data, and we do this by going up to the Add Data button. So once you click on that, it'll open up a dialog box. You guys probably won't see exactly what I see. I've actually connected to some folders before. Instead, you guys will probably see something that looks like this. You don't see your folder in there. In order to get to your folder, you have to click on the Connect to Folder button, which brings up a much more familiar Windows dialog box, where you can then navigate to your particular folder. Once you do that, it'll either automatically bring you to there. If it did not, you can double-click on this folder Connections, and then click on where you want to get your data from. So first, we want to add the data from that we downloaded from the NHGIS website. So I've saved mine here. I can open that up, and this is the data set we want to open. Hit Add, and it'll open it up into Arc. So this is what it looks like. In my case, it didn't actually go directly over. If you want to view all of the data, you can right-click on the data set within the table of contents and go to Zoom to Layer. So now all the data is centered inside of our viewing area. So now what we want to do is also add the other piece of data. This is the spreadsheet data that we worked on. So in order to do this, you want to now navigate to wherever you saved that. You may have to use the Connect to Folder dialog again. And you want to click on the data, the file we saved. In our case, in my case, I named it OLS Data for Mapping. Hit Add, and it will bring you inside to select which sheet you want. You should have saved it on sheet 1, so you can just select that and add. So now our table of contents box has changed a little bit. We now see where each of these things is located, which are these areas right here, and then the particular layers. In this case, this layer, because it has geographic information, is coded with this green color here. If you wanted to change the color, you can click on it there. Let's change it to blue just because we can. There we go. So you can do a variety of different things. If you want an outline, you can add an outline here so we can see all the counties. This checkbox decides whether or not you want to make something visible. So if you ever want to turn off a layer and not see it, you can click on the checkbox. So now we can open up our spreadsheet. So right-click on the spreadsheet and go to Open, and we can see all of the data that is in our spreadsheet here. And so now each level of the data is coded with this FIPS. And so what we want to do is merge these two together. In ArcGIS, you use the term. So now we want to open up the attribute table here. So we do that by right-clicking on the data, select Open Attribute. And so now we can see all the data that's located in here. If you notice, there is no FIPS code. We actually need to make it ourselves. And so in order to do this, we go up to this top here in Table Options. We select it, and we go to Add Field. We're going to create a new field. In this case, we're going to name it FIPS. We have to change the type from a short integer to a long integer. This basically determines how much data you can store in it. In our case, we need enough thousands places so that we can actually store the data. Hit OK, and it now generates this FIPS. As you can see, it's automatically set to zero for everyone. So we actually want to calculate this, and what we want to do is we want our FIPS code to have the first two digits be the state code, which is this 45 here, this 22 here, and the last three digits to be this county code, in this case 001, down here 003. So we can do this by right-clicking on FIPS and go to Field Calculator. Just say yes to this dialog box, and it opens up here. Though it may look a little complicated, it's actually really simple. It's just basically asking you to put the equation for what you want FIPS to equal in this area here. In this case, we want FIPS to equal our state NHGIS code, so NHGIS state, and we want to multiply that by 100, and then we want to add our NHGIS county and divide that by 10. Normally, when you're dealing with data, if you've downloaded both the GIS files and the data files from the census, all from NHGIS, they'll actually share this GIS join to and this GIS join. So normally you can actually just merge them on these. It's just the data that we're dealing with here in this spreadsheet doesn't have that. So if you notice, it finished our FIPS calculations, and as you can see, we now have those first two digits corresponding to the state and the last three digits corresponding to the county. So this is what we want. We can X out of this. So now what we need to do is we want to join these two files together or merge them as you would in Stata. So we do this by, again, right-clicking on the one that has the geographic information, going to Joins and Relate, and selecting Join. We want to join attributes from a table, so if it's on this spatial location, we click Join Attributes from a Table, and we need to select the field that this layer will be joined on. In our case, we want to do FIPS. It automatically will select FIPS from the other one because it figures out that these are a match. If you had multiple tables, you could select which table you want. Here, we only have one, so we don't need to. We also only want to keep matching records, so we can hit OK. This will run, and you notice Alaska disappears. We still have Hawaii, and so that's a bit of a problem. So we want to get rid of Hawaii. We can do this in a variety of, in two different ways. We basically want to select all the area that's not Hawaii. So we can either do that by going to the selection and select by attributes. And so we could select from U.S. County 2000, where state equals get unique values. In this case, it's numbers, so these are all the different states. I don't have Hawaii's state code memorized, so we don't want that. Instead, we probably want name, which is state name here, equals get unique values, and we can see them all here. So if we select Hawaii, apply, you'll notice here it lights up with this light blue around it. That means it's selected. And in fact, if we open up this attribute table, you can see down here there are four selected features. And as we scroll down, you can see there's a couple of them right there. So that's one of these selected values. And in fact, if you want to look at only selected values, you can click here, and all of the selected values will show up. In our case, we don't want to only select Hawaii. We want to select everyone but Hawaii. So we can do this by going into here and clicking Switch Selection. So we've now selected all of them except Hawaii. And as you can see on our screen, that showed up by having all of these here, and Hawaii is not lit up. We can clear selected features here. The other way to do it would be by a geographical select. So we actually just use this selection box and we highlight over all the data we want. In this case, I select that. It gets the exact same number of features, 3,106. So now we have this data set where we've selected these features and we've joined this. So we want to export it to a new data. We do that by right-clicking, going to Data, and going to Export Data. This opens up here. And it's just going to export our selected data, and it's going to save all that information we joined on. So we open up here, and we're going to label it. In my case, I'm going to label it export join 48 for the lower 48. You hit save, hit OK. It'll slowly export it out, and then it'll ask you if you want to add it to your screen. So this may take a little while to run. There you go. Do you want to add the exported layer? Data to the map as a layer. Select yes. We now actually don't need these anymore. So we can right-click on this and remove it, right-click on this and remove it, and we can now switch right over here. And so here we have our data. Again, now that we don't have Alaska and Hawaii, we want to zoom in a little bit, so we can right-click and go zoom to layer. Now looking at this, you might notice that there appear to be two white patches right here and right here. These are actually counties for which we don't have data for. This is primarily because they're small counties that are largely uninhabited. This is Loving County, Texas. I think it has a population of about 80 people in it. So we just don't have data for these counties, so they've been dropped from the observations, which is fine. So now that we have this data, I want to show you a couple cool things that we can do in ARC before we run any analysis. So one of the big things that you can do with ARC is display spatial data in really cool ways. So right now we're just looking at the map of the U.S. with all of the little counties and just the outlines. Everything's one color. Doesn't seem really interesting. However, if we right-click on our data and go down to properties, it'll open up a dialog box right here. Once that dialog box loads, you may be in this general, you may be in any of these. I want you to go to symbology, click on quantities, go to graduated symbols, and under the value field, you can select what you want to display. So in our case, why don't we look more closely at these high-cost loans? So that's this percent high cost right here. These are the high-cost loans in 2006. Looking at this data here, you can see it automatically filled in five classes. We can change how many classes we want. If we want seven, you know, pretty much any number all the way from 1 to 32. You can also change exactly how it's classified. In this case, it brings up a histogram showing us all of the different values. We can select our own values by typing in where we want it here, or we can select different methods. The natural breaks is a commonly used method. Another one would be a quantile, where it divides it equal amounts of data in each section. Another one would be an equal interval, where there's uniform distance between all of them. I'll just leave it at natural breaks. You guys can play around with that on your own. We hit apply and then OK. And so now we can actually see how our data varies across space. So if you look, you'll notice there's a high concentration of these high-cost loans in this Mississippi Valley region. There also seems to be a section extending throughout this kind of Great Plains region and two kind of arms running along the coastal mountains and along the Appalachian Mountains right here. So now that we've gone through the basics of ARC and how to add in data and visualize it and search and join, we'll begin to start actually looking at how we can calculate.